you all know, this course is about functional analysis. The code is MA5020. And I also want to know the following, that we have classes on Tuesday, Wednesday and Friday. And Wednesday it is afternoon. So Wednesday starts at 2:30. And I want to go up to 4 o'clock. And how many of you have problem for it? So if you have issue with going up to 4 o'clock, then we can say yes. If you don't have any problem, then you can say no, of course. If you have problem, then say yes. Okay, I don't see anybody have a problem as such. Okay. So if necessary, we will kind of extend that class. Then another notion is that we will have some class teaching. We will be discussing something here. So that will be so we will have some learning part. And maybe last, depending on what we are dealing on that day, maybe last around 20 minutes, maybe approximately. So we'll have some discussion. This is the plan now, as of now. Let's see how it goes on. And so how do we go about doing the discussion? I will, there is a provision in Zoom to have, create small meetings, okay? It's called breakout rooms. Okay, so I'll divide you into smaller groups and I would expect you to discuss. So what is to be discussed? That first thing is that, so what to discuss in that time? It's actually just revise what is done in the class. Okay, that's the first thing. So you don't need to go ahead. First, quickly look at what is possibly done in the class. Maybe some definition, some difficulty, some understanding difficulty will be there. So that you discuss with your peers and get to know what is that. Okay, that's the first step. And if there is any, if there is anything, gaps are felt out, that you can fill. So you can fill the gaps at that time. And if there is some exercise left out, you can think about that after that. So whatever is given as exercise or anything in the classroom, that you don't need to spend any discussion time. That you can do it later. If time permits, if you could finish the first two, then you go for the exercise. Okay. And it may not be the same group all the time, so make sure that you are able to communicate with each other appropriately. Is that clear? What I've said? What was this? Okay. Right, thank you. So so some of these students, for example, some of the MSc students who have already done a course in the last semester may know this thing, it is the same. So maybe you need to take a lead in the discussion time, that what is expected and what you can, what way you can get the data. So let's start. So what I also ask is that can somebody be a timekeeper and you can say that once it is 40 minutes are over. For example, let somebody remind me at 11:40 today, so that we know. We can quickly look for closing up and having a small discussion at least for some time. Okay, so now getting into this course. So this functional stress course, what are the kind of prerequisites? As you already know, somebody had a difficulty in registration and other things, still you may be having. The reason is the following, that this course expects the following, that you should have a little bit knowledge about rail analysis. Much prior to that, you need to know a little bit about linear algebra. So wherever needed, we can quickly go through, but since it's the first class, I would also, it is better for me if I tell what is expected so that you can quickly look at. So a reasonable amount of understanding of linear algebra, and then which means the vector spaces and basis and other stuff. And real answers, at least you must have some idea about sequence, series, converging, least upper bounds, greatest lower bound, supreme bound, infimum. These kind of things is expected from the real analysis. And if you are also aware of topology, so your upper bounds, lower bounds, and supreme bound, infimum. Make sure you go back and check these things. In the case of topology, even if you, I know that some of you have not done topology, but there is some connection with whatever you have learned in the analysis, at least what do you mean by open sets, closed sets, some other notions of bounded set, compact set, this kind of thing. And then it is also good if you have a background of machine theory. So if you are familiar, it will be even more good. But if you have not done again the machine theory, I know that some of you have not done. So in that case, what I'm expecting, again, there is a part of real analysis that you learned, which includes some kind of integration, which you have done in your calculus as well as in your real analysis course. At least the Riemann integral part. There is some upper sum, lower sum. How do you define integration of a function? What kind of functions are integrable, Riemann integrable? And the measure theory is slightly more. So if needed, if you want to understand those things, it is. I would advise that you to just go through at least some of the basic parts. Maybe even looking through Wikipedia page on measure theory will help you at least to make sure certain terms. Or we can discuss in your discussion time, you can find out from the other people. MSc students, many of them I would have done this. So you can ask them what is the better place to start with. You don't need to completely go through the course. Whichever is necessary at that time, you just quickly revise. Or in the respective classes, find out where you can find out the source to get a contact. Okay, so so mainly I would expect this. This I know that most of you have done. All of you have done. In fact, that's a basic prerequisite. So the notion that in this first. This function analysis, as the name suggests, it is actually analysis of functions. So the appropriate title would be, it is analysis of functions. But to discuss about the functions, we need a domain and codomain. So there are some sets also, underlying sets also involved. And so we should be clear about what are the objects that we are going to discuss. So let us make sure that what is the base that we want to discuss. So throughout this course, all of our sets, wherever we are going to discuss, are going to be vector spaces. So you are all, I hope you are all familiar. How many of you are, all of you familiar with vector space? Yes or no? Okay. So it's a set. I'll call it name B. But in our code, we will change the name into X. That doesn't matter. So B. And there will be an addition. That means you can add two vectors. And you can, there is also a dot called scalar multiplication. So this is what is known as vector addition. And this is scalar multiplication. So it satisfies number of properties. And if it satisfies, then you call this set with these two operations as a vector space. And to define the scalar multiplication, so the vector addition is, if you give me two vectors, I can add them. The scalar multiplication is, you give a scalar and a vector, I can multiply, and the end product will also be, end product will be again a vector. So there is some scalar field, there is a field in the background. There is a very algebraic definition of a field, but for our course, we are conveniently restricting ourselves to, whenever I say field, it is either R, set of all real numbers, or the complex. Which means we are going to restrict ourselves to only vector spaces over real numbers or complex numbers. So in general, this R or C, if I want to say that anything can be there, then I may use the letter K. So K means either it is real, or depending on the context, the idea, the set will be very clear. Now there is all of you are familiar with distance notion. So quick examples are vector spaces is as you know you are familiar with real numbers is a vector space with the field as real, complex numbers is a vector space with complex numbers as the underlying field. Addition of scalars is addition of two complex numbers is clear. Scalar multiple of a complex number with another complex number is clear. And in fact, a little more involved, not involved, at least to make the monotonicity, is that if you consider the complex numbers, you can think of it as a vector space over real numbers. So you are taking addition of two complex numbers that is defined, and scalar multiple, that is a real number multiplied with a complex number, ends up into another complex number. So that's a vector space. So complex numbers over real is also a vector space. And you have studied some notion of distance, which deals with how to find out a distance between two. At least you have done this in the real number case, in general between points on the plane. So in the case of real number, if I give you two points, then you look at the distance between them as modulus of a minus b. If a and b are two real numbers, the modulus of a minus b gives the distance between a and b. Same thing in the case of plane, you will call it as the distance between two points, x1 by 1, x2 by 2. Then it is x2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square. So there is a distance notion. So the underlying fact, soon we will come back to this distance notion. In our case, this will come later. Right now, since vector space is the underlying set, the elements of the vector space are called vectors. So elements of vector space are called vectors. So keep this in mind. That means your complex number is also a vector, your real number is also a vector. In fact, if you are familiar with the set of all n by n matrices, then that matrix is also a vector. As long as it is an element of some vector space, we can call it as vector. That's our definition of vector. So for this vector, we want to define some notion of length. again, real numbers we can define. If you give me a number, the length of that number is modulus of that. That is what we can call. Or this is more familiar in the case of planes, that if you give me a vector, then I look at if this is the vector v, I consider what is known as this length. This will give me the length of that vector. So the first step in the course of functional analysis is to define this notion of length. And we don't call that as length here. We call it another name called norm. So what is a norm? So it's a function. It's actually a function from this vector space V. And if you give me any vector, I find out the length. And that length is going to be some real number. So this ends up in real number. So this is actually a function from V to R. So it should satisfy a number of properties. Since we are going to fix with some notation, we don't use this notation here. I'll call it as the notation. Because if I call f is a function from v to r, then I have to write what is f of x. Now I will write this x you will write inside these two lines notion. So this is notation called. So this is a norm notation. So it has. So we want to say something is a norm. It could be anything. All I needed, it should be a function from V to R. So I want only few conditions it should satisfy. And if it satisfies these conditions, then I will define this to be the length. But the conditions that what we are expecting is very natural. If at all I want to say something as norm of nx. So right now here itself, I am doing this change also. Let me call this V as x. So what is this? This x is the reference. So x is a vector space and small x is from this vector space x. So norm of x, the first condition is that length has to be a non-negative real number. So we want this. And the second part is there here, which is if norm of x, if x is 0, then what will be the length? Length should be 0. Okay, so what we are saying is if x is 0, then you want the length of the vector has to be 0. But not only that, we want the other way up. So we are demanding that. So the only vector whose length is 0 has to be 0. Okay, so these are kind of two conditions. Next. There is a, in the vector space, there is a scalar multiple. Is there? So I should ask how it behaves with the scalar multiple. So this alpha is a scalar and x is an element from the space x. And I want to say that what is this? So what is the natural thing? So if I give you a vector v and a length, and if I multiply by 2, then its length has to be 2 times of that length. And if I multiply by minus 2, the length has to be, the vector has become, so this is a vector x. Then if I consider minus 2 times x, it will be like this side. What is the connection between this x and this? So you want, whatever may be the scalar, you want to consider this to be 2 times of the number. Okay, so that's the second condition. So it should be modulus of alpha times number. And of course, this should be true for all elements in the scalar. And x is coming from this space. This is also from all x. Third condition, there is an addition. So with respect to addition, how it behaves is the next thing that we want to look at. So if I give you two vectors from this space, then so look at again. So this is some x and this is y, and x plus y will be here. So we find out by completing the parallelogram. This is x plus y. So this length, what we want it to be length of this. So what we want is that if you know the triangle length, you know that if I take the diagonal part, that length has to be less than or equal to taking each of them separately. So look at that, it's very, all these demands, whatever we want this function called norm should satisfy, is natural to the length. Length has to be non-negative, that means it has to be a positive real number. And the only vector for which the length is negative, and it behaves like this, it's scalar multiple. And if I take the sum of two vectors and if I find out the length, that should be less than or equal to taking individual lengths. So these are having some names. So the first one is this is called so this is some kind of non-negative condition. Or sometimes it's called positive. It's a positive condition. So norm is positive. And this is something called definiteness. It's a definite. And this is homogeneous. It doesn't matter if you don't remember the name. All we are saying homogeneous means it's lengths are preserved, appropriate scalings are preserved. And this one, as you are familiar, you can see that it's coming from the triangle. So it's called triangle inequality. So now itself I am saying that if at all, so first part of the course we will be looking at different norms. So first we make familiar with ourselves with lot of norms, and in the process of checking whether it is a norm, in the first property non-negativeness may not be very difficult, but the definiteness may be difficult. Saying if x is 0, proving norm x is 0 may be easier. But if norm x is 0, proving that element is 0 may be a difficult part. And most of the cases, homogeneous will work out easily. And again, the difficult part will be the triangle inequality. So it's the second part of one, and the third part will have difficulty in most of the time. Now, if at all such a function satisfying these properties, these three properties, is called a norm. So a norm, by definition, is a function from the vector space to R. That's the satisfying the property 1, 2, and 3. It's called a norm. Now the last part of the definition. That if you have a vector space X, and on that if you can define this norm, such a norm, it's called norm basis. And we will abbreviate this as NLS. Norm-linear space. It's not a very standard abbreviation, of course, but many places you may see it. So non-linear space is the one you have a vector space. So very precisely speaking, it has it's actually there is a vector scalar multiple and also a norm. There are four parts in the definition of non-linear. So the next, in 1 minute, I will give the first example and then you can discuss things further. Which is, of course, my space X is real numbers with usual addition and scalar multiplication, and the field is also real numbers. And now I need to define the norm. So norm is a function now from R to R. there is an obvious choice, which is how it is defined. So norm of any real number is defined to be modulus. So I just want to ask somebody if you can give. Yeah, Neha. When I call you, you can unmute and speak.
Yes, sir.
What is the definition of this modulus of it for a real number?
Sorry, sir. I didn't get your question.
No, what is the definition of mod x? What is mod x?
Mod x.
For a real number.
Sorry, it's... Mod x. X for x greater than equals to 0 or minus x for x less than 0.
Okay, so then x is bigger than or equal to 0. And minus x, then x is less than or equal to 0. You can avoid one of the inequality if you want, but still it's not creating a problem. But what I would address, my definition of mod x is the following. Yeah, you can mute yourself. So my definition of mod x is, it is the maximum of x and minus x. Okay. So this is my definition of mod x. Now let us quickly check whether it is actually a nonlinear space. The question is now whether this R with this modulus. Okay, is it a nonlinear space? So R was a vector space that we are already aware of, so nothing to check there. Only I need to check that whether this modulus that is defined here, does it creates a norm. So let's check that. If modulus of any real number non-negative, this one, yes, because it is taken to be maximum of x and minus x. If it is negative, then x is also less than 0, minus x is also less than 0. So there will be a problem. Okay, so it has to be bigger than or equal to 0. I want you to go through the definition. And we'll come back to the definition quickly. What about scalar multiple? If I multiply by alpha with the real number, what is the alpha? Alpha is from the field. So in this case, what is the underlying field? So here the field is understood. So if I take a real number from the field alpha and my x vector is also a real number r, and I take the modulus of that, and you know that it is actually equal to modulus of alpha into modulus. I want you to check that. So don't assume that. Check that. It's essentially asking what is the modulus of alpha into x is modulus of alpha into modulus of x using this definition. Next, triangle inequality. You may think it is true, modulus of x plus y is less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. But I want you to go through the proof very clearly. For example, I discuss one case. By your definition, modulus of x plus y is, it is maximum of x plus y or minus x minus y. Suppose this maximum is x plus y. Then can you see that x plus y is less than or equal to mod x plus mod y? That's the first case. And prove similarly, minus x minus y is also less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. Now then put together to conclude, each of them is less than mod x plus mod y. So maximum also has to be less than mod x plus mod y. That gives the triangle inequality. And now for the definiteness, if mod of x is 0, if x is 0, mod x is 0 is immediate. Because if x is 0, both x and minus x are 0, so maximum of that is 0.